childish things. There's a certain level of consciousness that a real man has. So tonight, if you didn't see those, both of those are up on YouTube at Robert Blakes. You can go to my YouTube channel at Robert Blakes and you can see parts 1 and 2. But tonight in this final installment, this time, because the Manhood Academy is something that I'm going to revisit, just like I do the father-daughter talk, we'll have other lessons that I will be coming and sharing and, you know, letting you know from time to time. So this will be an ongoing subject matter for us here in the Periscope Worship Center. But tonight we're talking about the commission of a real man. The commission of a real man. And a commission is a special assignment given to a person or group. You know, police officers to my left, my chief armor bearer and my head deacon for our East New Orleans location is sitting. And he's been a police officer for how many years now? How many?
40.
40 years. And when a man comes through the academy and he finishes, they commission him to protect and to serve. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Likewise, manhood, there's a commission on manhood. There's an assignment for every man to fulfill, and that's what I want to deal with tonight. As David said to his son Solomon in 1 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, David's getting ready to die. Solomon's getting ready to ascend to the throne. Solomon's just 12 years old, and David says to him, I'm getting ready to die, but be strong and show thyself a man. We cannot conclude that you are a man just because you have a beard. We cannot conclude that you are a man just because you're 6 feet or 6 foot tall. We cannot conclude that you are a man because the calendar says you're 21 years old. You have to show yourself a man. Quite often in this society, we males expect women to respect us and to submit to us before we've shown them anything. There's a commission on a real man's life. There's an assignment given to him by God for him to fulfill. Let's jump right in so that I don't take too much time tonight, people waiting around for me. Number one, a real man is commissioned by God to sacrifice for his family. A real man is commissioned by God to sacrifice for his family. I don't like these numbers. My numbers have been too low. I don't know what's going on, but I don't like it. Y'all got to help me do better than this. I don't like going backwards now. A real man sacrifices for his family. Whenever you find a so-called man that does not want to sacrifice for you, run, Forrest, run. Or should I say, run, Florestine, run. Because a real man is a sacrificer. When we look at the first man, Adam, we see sacrifice demonstrated. Because a part of God's requirement for him to have a woman was that he had to sacrifice. What do I mean by that? Adam had to, well, go look in Genesis 2. Genesis 2. Verses 21 through 23. Maybe it's just later and people have missed me. Or maybe people are asleep. I'm certain that a lot of the young boys are asleep, and I understand that. Genesis 2, verses 21 through 23 says, and the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And God took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman. Now, so we see here, before God gave this brother a woman, he made him sacrifice. Now, God could have spoken that woman into existence, but God says, lay down, I'm going to cut you open, and I'm going to take her out of you. You're going to give something of yourself. You're going to give of yourself before I will give you something as precious as a woman. Any man that does not understand that he has to sacrifice is not fit to be anybody's so-called husband. He will be a pseudo-husband, a fake husband, a less than honorable, less than adequate husband, because a real man has to sacrifice. God made Adam sacrifice. Adam had to sacrifice for Eve for her to even exist. Is that making sense? Adam could only claim Eve. Now watch this. It goes on to say, and Adam said, after he gave up his rib, God formed her, and then God brought her, woke Adam up, and the Bible says, and Adam said, this is now bone of my bones. All right, there we go. And flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Adam could only claim Eve after he sacrificed for her. Adam could only claim Eve after he sacrificed for her. Look what the Bible says in Ephesians 5. See, this is the kind of stuff that separates the boys from the men. These grown boys don't want to sacrifice. They want you to sacrifice for them, but they don't want to sacrifice for you. And the Bible explicitly instructs the man to sacrifice for the woman. We want women to submit before we sacrifice. That's out of order. The man has to sacrifice before the woman even views him as eligible for submission. Look what Ephesians 5, 24 and 25 says. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, watch this, even as Christ also loved the church and gave, sacrificed himself for it. So the man is commissioned to sacrifice for the wife slash the family. The man is commissioned to sacrifice for the family, to sacrifice for the wife. Ladies, never entertain a man that will not sacrifice for you, a man that will not go out of his way for you is not even worthy of another conversation. Young men, always sacrifice for your woman. See, when you sacrifice for that woman, nobody has to beat her over the head. Nobody has to try to force her into submission. When a woman sees that a man will sacrifice himself for her, submission comes naturally. So the first commission of man is the sacrifice. The second commission of man, given by God, is to provide. To provide for his own. God gave Adam a purpose, and then God gave Adam resources before he ever gave him a woman or family. You don't need to be trying to holler at no woman if you don't have a job. If you don't have a job, don't look for a woman right now. Look for a job. Because a man is supposed to provide for his woman. Now, you know, when you and a man, a woman has been, man been down with you and y'all married and y'all been together, he falls upon some rough times. You don't dump a man that's been faithful to you because he runs upon rough times. But you're certainly not supposed to be seriously entertaining a man that don't have no job and ain't trying to find one. And in fact about it, as a man, listen to me, as a man, never try to entertain a woman seriously when you don't have your money right. Because you are commissioned by God to provide for the woman. Now, of course, this is a day and time that to live a certain way sometimes it requires two-income households. I feel you on that. But always view your wife's contributions financially as her helping you. Always view that as her helping you. That's really not her responsibility. Sometimes we want women to work 8 hours a day, then come home, clean the house up, cook, take care of the kids, have sex all night. Genesis 2, 15 through 18 says, and the Lord God took the man, put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. God gave him a job. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. He had a home, he had a place, and he had a job. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him. After God gave him a place to stay, a job, and an understanding of his purpose, then God says, it's not good for this guy to be alone. Until you have those things in place, somewhere to stay, not your mama's house, a job, and understand your purpose, it is good for you to be alone. God left him alone until he got these things in place. Because one of the commissions of a man is to provide. Look what 1 Timothy 5, 7 through 8 says. And these things, 7 and 8 says, these things give in charge that they may be blameless. But if any provide not for his and especially for those of his own house, he hath denied the faith and is worse than an infidel. A man is a provider. A man is a provider. Now, what happens today, I got to keep bouncing back because I have a lot of women on here and I need you to understand how this applies to you as well. An infidel is worse than an unbeliever. Many times, brothers fall short on the provision side because sisters are so well educated and earn so much that you cripple the manhood in these dudes by enabling them. You want a man so bad, you fulfill his role and you let him slip into a feminized position of being provided for. When a man is conscious of his responsibility to provide, it causes him to make some fundamental adjustments. Number one, he will intentionally make adjustments to his presentation, his appearance, his dress code. See, when you know you're a provider, you're not gonna wear your pants with your drawers. I don't know if y'all see drawers in other parts of the world, in the country. Your underwear, your underclothes showing because you need a job. When you know you got to provide, you're not going to write kill across your forehead because ain't nobody going to hire you unless you're a rapper. He will develop a relentless work ethic. When a man understands his commission to provide, he will develop a relentless work ethic. His woman will have to tell him to stop. Now, let me bounce back to you sisters. God gives you men that provide tremendously, and then you're not satisfied. You're not happy. You crying and complaining about he working too much, but he paying all these bills that you're making. You want a new car every 2 years. You want another big old house. You want to go buy all these bags and purses, and then you're going to complain about the man working. Let the man be the man. You want him to stay home, downgrade your lifestyle, because real men provide. You got to make a real man stop working. He ain't laying around on no couch eating no cereal with no wife beating them prison slippers on. Man working at you that you complain, you work too much. Leave the man alone. All that money you spending, running up all them credit cards, talking about the man work too much. Go sit down somewhere. And then thirdly, when he understands his role as provider, he develops a wiser relationship with money. He doesn't waste money like a foolish man. Bible says in Proverbs 13:22, a good man leaveth an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. My baby hanging in here with me. Got one of my daughters. She just sitting in the cut back there, watching her dad work. All right. Third commission of a man is to protect those in his care. After honoring God, the man understands that he is to protect the woman. So what does this mean? This means that you never have to, a real man will never put his hands on a woman. Anytime you get an inkling to raise your hands to a woman, you know you're not a man. So what do you do as a Christian woman meets a man that's working but went through a divorce? What you mean? You interested in him? Get to know him. Get to know him. If the question goes deeper, you know, probably email me so everybody don't be all up in your business. You email me at pastorrcblakes@gmail.com and I can go a little deeper, but you meet a Christian man and you like him and he went through a divorce, get to know him. All right, he protects those in his care. He protects his woman. He protects his children. He doesn't harm them. Little boys fight with girls. Little boys fight with little girls. Grown men protect women. Even if she put his hands on him, you know, number one, it's not often that a woman, now you got some that's on a different level, but it's not often that a woman can really hurt a man. Be honest with you. Now all he got to do is that. He block off with that. She going to hurt a little hand hitting him on his forearm. She going to leave him alone. So, you know, don't come to me with, well, she put her hands on me. No, doc. No. Real men protect women. They don't hurt women. You are commissioned by God to protect his daughter. In every way, physically, emotionally, every way, spiritually. That's why I don't understand how as a man of a family and a household, you can sit in your lazy boy on Sunday and let your woman and your children go and let another man indoctrinate them and you don't have a clue what they're hearing. And you're the priest of your house. See, you're supposed to be in the house with people like me talking to your family. You are supposed to be in the house hearing what I'm saying. Because you have to protect your family physically, spiritually, emotionally, and otherwise. It's irresponsible for you to send your wife and your children to a place for somebody else to teach them. Now, you don't need to stop your wife from going to church if you don't plan on leading. But back to my main point, he protects. When Adam failed to protect Eve, watch this. When Adam failed to protect Eve, she got deceived. Adam wasn't fulfilling his responsibility, his commission to protect his woman. God gave Adam the plan. And Adam was supposed to cover his woman. He did not cover her. I don't know what he was doing, but he wasn't covering his woman like he was supposed to. Otherwise, she wouldn't have had all of these crazy conversations with this snake. Ephesians 5:20-29 says, so ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. You know what? Your woman, your wife, your children should never be afraid of you. You should never go into your house and your family is afraid of you. They should always feel more secure when you are around. You should not be a terrorist to your family. So a man is commissioned by God to protect, to respect, and to honor the woman. It's commissioned by God to protect, respect, and honor the woman. Look what 1 Peter 3:7 says. Likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge. Let me see something here. It says, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel. And as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. He says, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, putting her on a certain level of respect, putting her on a certain level of esteem. Because your role is to protect your woman. And then, watch this. The fourth commission of a man is to guide the wife spiritually. I kind of got ahead of myself. Yeah, women are weaker, and when it talks about women being weaker, it's really talking about her being physically weaker. It's talking about her being physically weaker, and that the man should not take advantage of her being physically weaker. What do you do when you made mistakes with your wife? You apologize. You apologize, and you lay out the plan for how you're going to change. Because, you know, I haven't always been, I've made mistakes with my wife, and I've had to apologize, and I've had to adjust, and I had to come back and change some other stuff, and I had to adjust. None of us are perfect. I'm still getting stuff right that I've not, you know, still getting stuff right. Just because I'm on here talking to y'all don't mean I'm perfect. I'm still getting stuff right, but if a sincere apology, and laying out a plan for how we're going to actually move forward and get this thing right goes a long way. Number one, women put up with a whole lot more stuff out of us than we would of them. So more than likely, she's going to receive your apology, especially if it's sincere. And see, a lot of brothers have made mistakes because they've never had this kind of teaching. All we've been indoctrinated with is the stuff that the world... Somebody said, I just cussed my husband out. Oh, Lord, Jesus. Oh, Lord. My God. All right, watch this. All right, where did I leave off at? Number four, the man is to guide the wife. He's commissioned to guide the wife spiritually. God gave his word to Adam. He gave his word to Adam and made Adam responsible to teach Eve. One of man's original assignments was to be the priest of his family and society. That's why I'm telling you, brothers, do not watch your family go to worship and you sitting at home. Do not watch your family go to worship and you sitting at home. You are to be the priest of your family. Ideally, the pastor of the church should lead you. You and the pastor should have a significant father-son relationship, and then you should lead your family. Your family should follow you as you follow your pastor, as he follows Christ. You shouldn't be home watching football. So look what the Bible says in Genesis 3:7-9. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked. This is after they ate of the fruit God told them not to eat of. But God gave all of these instructions to Adam. Adam was to pass this down to Eve. Adam did not cover, protect his woman. She got caught up with this serpent, comes back and entices and influences Adam, which is a lesson into itself, the power of a woman's influence over man. A woman's influence talked a man out of paradise. It's another lesson for another day, but think about it. You have a lot of influence as a woman over your man. A woman's Eve's influence over Adam talked him out of paradise. And then, but long story short, Genesis 3:7-9, when God came to hold somebody accountable, he didn't ask for Eve. He said, Adam, where are you? You are responsible to guide your wife spiritually. Where are you? One of the commissions of a man is to guide his wife and family spiritually. Paul was teaching the word, and the women had so many questions. And you know, women are very inquisitive. They're learners. And Paul turned to the men and said, look, it's just getting out of hand here. Y'all go home and teach your wives. Don't let them come here asking me all these questions because it's prolonging our services. So brothers, y'all know what I'm putting down. Go home and teach your wives. As a man, you should be equipped to teach your wife the word of God. When she comes to church and hears the pastor, she ought to be able to say, man, my husband just told me that. Because one of your commissions is to guide your wife spiritually. All right. So Adam's, and when you see Adam's failure spiritually impacted the entire family. And then finally, the fifth commission of a man. Wow, boy, this time flies. Is to produce the next generation of men. How can he teach and lead if he's not a man of God? Well, he has to be saved, and he can teach and lead in certain aspects. If you're married to him already and he doesn't know God, you got to pray for him, and the Bible declares that he can possibly be sanctified by the prayers of the righteous mate. But this is why the Bible says don't be unequally yoked. You avoid all of these issues. You avoid all of these issues. Can't lead where you don't go or teach what you don't know. This is correct. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, bro. What is the book you are teaching out? I'm not teaching out of a book. These are my notes. These are my notes I put together for this particular teaching. I'm not one of these preachers that has like a memory that hold all that stuff. I don't do that. So I write everything. I put everything down. You know, why do I need to strain my brain when I have a perfectly good iPad? So that's the way I roll. Some people want to impress you with great memories. I'd rather take my thoughts and put them down so that, you know, I can read them when I want to read them. I ain't got to walk around and try to remember all of that. And when I'm dead, somebody else can read them. So I'm reading from my iPad. It's kind of hard for you to see it because it's so bright, but I'm reading from my iPad. These are my notes. So fifth. That thing is hard to say right now. You know that? Number five. Man is commissioned to produce. Will you ever do a program to help those of us that are looking for an equally yoked? Y'all got to kind of send me these topics because I can deal with that. I can deal with that. Yeah, that's awesome. Number five. You can send those topics to me. Can you be my spiritual advisor, Pastor Blakes, please? I would love to. It's just that I'm so limited. I don't feel like I'm always doing people a good service. But I will certainly try to do my best. The best way to communicate with me is through email, pastorrcblakes@gmail.com. And just kind of give me your heart, and then we'll see. We'll see what we can do. You need to come. I'm coming to Indy. What you talking about? I'm coming to Indy. Pastor Howard, put it back up there. I'm coming to Indy Sunday night, and I'm going to be there Monday night with the Father.